Rear-row SUVs have been persistently popular over the last decade, and with sales continuing to grow, automakers pay big attention to this segment. So much so that since the last time we did this test 2 years ago, we've had 3 brand new vehicles, a full redesign, and a refreshed vehicle, all of which are participating in our test here. 7 vehicles, starting with the Chevrolet Traverse, the Ford Explorer, the Honda Pilot, the Hyundai Palisade, the Kia Telluride, the Subaru Ascent, and our champion from last time, the Volkswagen Atlas. Let's see how they stack up. Real quickly, we had 7 vehicles in this challenge. Pretty big field, but there are a few that weren't here that we do want to address. So Durango, Outlander, Nissan Pathfinder either don't sell enough, haven't been updated recently enough to really be considered in this test. But the big omission, it would be the Toyota Highlander. And that's going to be redesigned for 2020. Wasn't quite ready now. And I mean, I don't blame Toyota for not really sending a 2019 here. I don't think it would have done very well.
We should add Mazda CX-9 to that list too. Yeah. Kind of like, you know, for one reason or another, it didn't make it.
I mean, we had 7 vehicles in this test. I mean, if you want to go up to 11 or 12 vehicles, that's going to be really kind of hard to do. So I think 7 was a good number. 7 was the representative of the segment as the major players in the industry. And these are the ones that people are going to look at and consider the most.
Mm-hmm. We'll start at the bottom with our 7th place finisher, the Honda Pilot. Now, I think that it's fair to say that in most of our comparison tests, especially ones that are this big, cars that sort of finish towards the bottom aren't necessarily ones that we would recommend, but I don't think that that is the case with this particular challenge.
Yeah, I mean, specifically for this one, last place is not last place. These 3 just kind of were lumped together. Some of them are a little bit older. Some of them haven't been refreshed recently, but they also, none of them scored anything huge. None of them scored any like major kudos or major winning category kind of points. This is all kind of a middle of the road test for a lot of these.
I kind of think that's the way the Pilot fared. I mean, it didn't really stink up the joint in terms of any particular thing, but it didn't really do outstandingly well in any other category. For me, it's just basically kind of a comfortable SUV that doesn't execute a few things well in terms of multimedia, user interface. I mean, it's got some touch sensitive buttons. It doesn't have a tuning knob. It's got a push button gear selector. These are all things that kind of make it harder to use day in and day out. The seats are comfortable, but the third row isn't great. It didn't have a huge amount of cargo space. And so, you know, you kind of go down and it's sort of death by a thousand cuts here.
Yeah, I think the interesting thing is you could own a Pilot and be pretty happy with it. But I think that once you sit in it, once you drive it for a bit, it becomes very clear that it's one of the older vehicles in this test. So it did get a refresh in 2019, where they kind of reworked the transmission, made that a little bit better, drivability improved, but not enough so that it's really going to leapfrog any of the newer contenders in this class. And I think that there's not really one thing that the Pilot stands out at, and its scoring kind of suffered for that.
Yeah, to me, it was a very solidly average crossover for this category. It was comfortable. The interior is not as nice as some of the other ones are. It was very dark in there as well. I mean, everything was black. Black trim, black back pieces, black upholstery.
Yeah, it was interior designed by Darth Vader.
It pretty much was. But the thing is, they kind of used that darkness to hide the fact that the materials aren't quite as good as some of the top players in this segment. So that really kind of stuck to me. You know.
Yeah, I mean, certainly we talk about kind of the consistency of interior quality. Does the automaker really cheap out when you go from the front seats to the rear seats? You know, are some of those kind of touch points, areas where your knees or your elbows land, are those kind of not padded? Do they use cheaper materials? And the Pilot had some really nicely constructed things. The climate controls felt really well constructed. But in a lot of those areas you were talking about, Aaron, I did think that Honda just dropped the ball.
We know they can do better.
Yeah, exactly. It did come in bottom in car seat accommodations, which we should mention we put these cars through a number of different tests. We measure cargo space, we see how well they accommodate several types of child safety seats, and the Pilot didn't do well in that particular category.
And can we talk about the automatic emergency braking? I think every one of us experienced the thing going off just without reason or responsibility. I was driving along, it went off for me 7 times in 30 minutes, twice without a vehicle actually in front of me to trigger the thing. And it not only just, you know, flashed the big brake warning at you, it also, on a couple of occasions, started to pulse the pedal and brake, even though the vehicle in front of me wasn't really a threat at that moment. I was paying attention, and I don't know why it went off, and it did it several times to all of us.
We should note also that that happened to us in a variety of conditions, so both on the street and on the highway, and it seemed that whatever was tracking, you're using to track a car in front of you just wasn't quite working. And like you said, when you're driving along and the pedal starts to pulse and there's nothing in front of you and the car is freaking out, you start to freak out. And then I think you're more likely to turn those sorts of systems off, which is really something that we want to avoid. We want to encourage
owners and drivers of these vehicles to keep all the safety systems on because they're there to keep you safe. So a lot of false positives will be really frustrating to people. They might turn it off, and then that might cause a collision that it could have otherwise avoided.
I'll add to that, the actual braking, when you intend to be braking, I took all of these cars out near our drive route on an empty road. I did 40 miles to zero panic braking, and the Pilot just seemed to take the longest to do that. It just seemed very modest in terms of its overall stopping power. When you really stood on it and did this panic stop, didn't impress me, especially compared to some of these others that, frankly, may have had better tires, better brakes, but the effect of it was more sure-footed stopping distance.
There are some high points for the Honda as well. The visibility was ranked up there, tied with one of the other vehicles. There's also above average comfort for the front seats. Everybody thought it was a pretty comfortable vehicle as well. Second row I thought was all right. There was a little bit of limitation on the legroom compared to some of the bigger vehicles here. Third row was just, nah. I actually did get into third row of all of these vehicles, and some I didn't have a problem doing that, was comfortable sitting back there, and some I couldn't get out fast enough.
The problem with the Honda, I mean, they put really nice, easy to access sliding features to get to the third row. I mean, there's just a button you press and the second row slides forward. But getting back to that third row, there's just a very narrow area to get through, especially when you compare it to something like the Volkswagen Atlas or even the Chevy Traverse on the one side where it does it. In the Honda, you really kind of just had to squeeze and angle your way back to the third row. And the third row wasn't terrible, but it wasn't great either.
I'm not also thrilled with the lack of a large, high center armrest in the front seats. You've got these fiddly little armrests that are attached to the actual front seats, and they're about that wide. And if you're already this wide, it doesn't really work for you that well. I would much rather have had a higher center armrest with more storage and actually something you could rest your arm on a lot more comfortably.
It seems like the way that we would summarize the Pilot is that it's all right. Does some things well, does some things not so well, and it kind of just peters out to average, which in this test, in such a crowded field with so many new competitors, means a last place finish that doesn't quite feel like a last place finish. So even though it's last, sort of a moral victory for Honda in that, I think that these are all issues that could be corrected in a redesigned Pilot, which we'll hopefully see in the next couple years.
Yep. If the Pilot had any glaring error, it was really kind of in the user interface. Those controls were difficult to use. It didn't have a tuning knob, it only had a volume knob. It's got some touch-sensitive controls. It's got a push-button gear selector. Now, we should mention, we had pretty much a top trim level of this SUV, and if you get a lower trim level, you get kind of a physical, traditional gear selector back. If you get a really low trim level, you even get a tuning knob again. But in our particular car, it kind of showed off the worst of what Honda is doing in this regard in the Pilot.
Sixth place finisher, the Traverse, only finished a few points above the Pilot, so almost an identical finish, even though it does technically finish in sixth. And I think, unlike the Pilot, we would all agree that the Traverse had more defined strengths and weaknesses.
I agree, yeah. Now, I didn't think the Traverse was as bad as the two of you thought it was. You guys really didn't seem to care for it. I actually found it to be very comfortable. I thought the interior had a higher quality than I'd expected it to. I'd been in some other Traverses, some earlier Traverses on lesser trim levels, and they're not that great. But this one, the High Country, actually was pretty decent, I thought. But the leather quality was good. I thought it was extremely comfortable. And I like the fact that when you look at all of these vehicles, there's two different sizes of these crossovers. They're all considered mid-size crossovers, but I mean, let's be honest here, some are definitely on the small side, like the Subaru Ascent and the Honda Pilot, and some are on the big side, like the Atlas and the Traverse. The Traverse is one of the larger ones, and I thought it was comfortable in pretty much all three rows. You could sit in the third row and as a full-sized adult, and it really wasn't a penalty box like you saw on some of the other ones.
Yeah, let's talk about how you get there though. I mean, the Traverse had a lot of just kind of obvious cost cutting going on here. The prior generation of the Traverse, like every other SUV we tested, had walk-in sliding access from both sides. Chevy took it away from the driver's side. Now it's only on the passenger side. There was just a lot of other cost cutting going on. I mean, it had a sunroof with the shade that when you shut it, it had this flimsy little clip that you had to attach to the front of where it was supposed to shut, and then when you flipped it up, it scrolled back. I mean, there was just so much about it that screamed cost cutting, screamed the cost cutting that's going on now at GM, parent of Chevrolet, that's just kind of rampant in a lot of their vehicles. The other thing about the Traverse is it was the second most expensive vehicle in the test, nearly tied with the most expensive, more than $54,000, and we had some of these other SUVs at $47,000, $48,000 to give you some perspective. And I mean, for that, it's just curious the features you don't get. No rain-sensing wipers, every other SUV had that. No second-row sunshades, every other SUV had that. No power-folding side mirrors, only one other SUV also didn't have that. So just not a great value story.
Even things like the height adjustable seatbelts have been taken out as well. So I mean, I do agree with you that the cost cutting that we've seen on some of these models from GM is really starting to get pervasive and it's starting to be noticed across the board. And we talked about you can only get into the third row from the passenger side. I mean, the only reason to do that is to take cost out. Every other one of these vehicles, you can get into the third row from either side of the vehicle, and the previous Traverse, you could do that as well. So to take that out does actually kind of negate a lot of the niceness of the parts of the interior that actually were quite comfortable and quite nice, because you look at these glaring omissions and you go, well, what were they thinking in that regard?
No, I think you're right in that the leather's very nice. It's just that the leather's not on everything. Everything that is not on, like the headliner is not a good material, and it doesn't even go down the pillars. The pillars are all plastic, A, B, and C. And so I think that the Traverse, you notice these things because they're so pervasive. Like all these SUVs had cost cutting. They're not luxury vehicles, and the third rows are all pretty much hard plastic. It's just that the Traverses was more noticeable to me. And again, at that price, you had two vehicles in this test that were $54,000. You drop all the way down to $50,000 to find the next ones. You drop all the way down to $46,000 for the next set. And it just didn't feel like it was worth that kind of money. Also for me, the driving experience didn't really live up. So good powertrain, good engine. Transmission was fine, but drives like the biggest vehicle here for sure. Kind of sloppy in turns, a lot of body roll, and just really not pleasant to drive. Not that any of these are great to drive, but this one was particularly, for me, unpleasant.
To me, it felt like it had abnormally long stopping distances. Like you'd hit the brakes and you'd really have to get into the brakes in order to bring to a stop. I thought it was going to be the heaviest vehicle here, but it's not. It's actually pretty competitive. It's almost 300 pounds lighter than the Subaru, believe it or not. But it felt like a really heavy vehicle when you're trying to change directions. The handling of it was really kind of slow. The steering is slow. The body rolls considerably. I mean, it is definitely tuned more towards comfort than any kind of athleticism. And these are not athletic vehicles to begin with, but you still want to have some kind of confidence. You still want to have some sort of entertainment on your commute. And there really just wasn't much of it in the Traverse at all.
I did think once all systems were going, you really got that V6 engine moving. It was a reasonably quick vehicle. It had a nice exhaust note to it. But for me, the transmission, the 9-speed automatic, was not great. It would occasionally seem very quick to give you a lower gear when it was downshifting, but then often it kind of gear hunted and stutter stepped through and decided later on, oh, we're going to give you a moment later, we're going to give you another gear. And when all was said and done, I mean, your kickdown took 2 seconds, 2.5 seconds, which was unacceptable when some of these other cars were taking closer to 1 second.
Yeah, unacceptable, and I think borderline unsafe. I think that's one of the things that we don't quite talk about enough when we're talking about accelerator lag. And that's if you're trying to shoot a gap between two cars, if you're trying to pass and the vehicle doesn't respond in the way that you think it will, it can cause problems when you're on the road. So I noticed the same thing with the transmission. It does need some sorting out. I don't know if any of the 9-speeds in this test were particularly good, but needs work there. Also, when we're talking about the Traverse, again, highs and lows. So pretty much five last place category finishes. It had the worst mileage of the bunch, the worst handling score, the worst braking score, the worst value because of its price, and tied for last in visibility.
So for mileage, we basically drove a 240-mile or so loop in all seven of these SUVs. We rotated drivers between each leg. You can read a lot more about this on Cars.com, but the Traverse actually had the worst as-tested mileage. It was 21.0 miles per gallon in our observations. That was last among some of these that were getting 23, 24, closer to 25 miles per gallon.
What the Traverse does have going for it is it's a big boy. First in cargo space, tied with the Explorer for maximum floor depth in the cargo area, and just lots and lots of space across all three rows. So whether you're carrying a lot of people or a lot of stuff, if size is, the most important thing to you, then you go for the Traverse.
And for many people, it is. I mean, if you've got a large family and you need to have that kind of room to haul the people, to haul the stuff from place to place, that cargo space and that passenger room does actually count for quite a bit.
Yeah, if you've got a lot of family and you don't think that they need to stay in nice accommodations, then you go ahead and get a Traverse.
Maybe you don't like your family. Maybe you just think, it's good enough for them. We'll take them along.
Fifth place, rounding out sort of what I would call the bottom grouping of our test, is the Subaru Ascent. Now, Subaru Ascent, brand new vehicle for 2019. This was the first challenge it got to participate in, and I would say that the results are mixed at best. So even though it got a fifth place finish, I think that I would actually recommend the other two vehicles that finished below it in more instances than the Ascent.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily bear out in the points because the Subaru actually did very well in the value category, but in terms of driving pleasure, and just enjoying the ride of the thing, I didn't like it. I did not like the Subaru. It did not feel comfortable to me in terms of how it works. The acceleration was fine, but the engine is loud. The transmission is very abrupt. It's very coarse. I didn't like the handling. I think it was very darty. It was kind of hard to keep it on center in various conditions, whether in urban driving or on the highway. To me, it didn't drive well. I just didn't enjoy the experience, especially compared with the refinement we saw in some of the other vehicles.
Yeah, I'm with you, Aaron. I mean, I think it had a turbo four-cylinder engine, so did the Ford Explorer, but I mean, it attached that to a continuously variable automatic transmission, the only CVT in the test, and that showed. I mean, this CVT, to its credit, pretty quick at kind of kicking up revs when you need it to, but you can't avoid that kind of droning sensation which you get, especially getting up to highway speeds, and that four-cylinder is just kind of noisy. It has this sort of raspy exhaust note. It's not really that quick when you really step on it. Yeah, just not a fun vehicle, just in terms of drivetrain.
I thought it was noisy overall, not just the engine. I thought there was more road and tire noise in the Ascent than you get in any of the other competitors. And I also think it's weird because it kind of presents well, right? Like, you look at the interior, dark brown leather, looks very nice. At a quick glance, everything looks pretty good. But then once you sit in it and you kind of start to drive it around, all the veneer drops off and you're left with something that feels a little bit deficient. I would say that if each of us had a choice, had all the keys laid out in front of us, none of us are taking the Ascent for the weekend or for the day home.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, it does do some things well. It's very easy to see out of. Subaru typically does that well. And the pillars are fairly narrow. There's nice tall windows. There's a nice big rear window. It was one of two to even augment that with a camera-based rear view mirror, which some people love it, some people hate it. But then you get a complete view of what's behind you through a camera.
Love it or do you hate it?
I've learned to like it. I hated it at first, and I've learned to kind of accept that, well, this is like looking behind you without any pillars or head restraints or anything, and once you get used to it, it works.
Yeah, but this is why you're married and I'm
but,
not.
But if you've got progressive bifocals, it's actually very hard to use one of those camera mirrors because
really?
You have to change, when you're looking at a normal rear view mirror, mm-hmm. you're looking at basically 100 feet behind the car. Mm-hmm. It's the same as you're looking in the forward windshield, you're still looking 100 feet in front of the car, or however long you're looking. When you change that to the camera mirror, you're basically now looking at another screen that's inside the car. Your focal point is changed. So instead of normally looking forward and looking at the rear view mirror and not having to change your focus, you suddenly have to change your focus to realize you're just looking at that mirror. You're not looking behind the vehicle. You're looking at that actual screen. And for somebody with progressive bifocals, you have to change your head around. You have to look a certain way to try and get it to focus, or it just doesn't work very well.
Speaking of screens, Subaru does something unique with their vehicles where they put that third kind of screen above the dashboard. So that really is kind of what houses a lot of your EyeSight, which is their suite of safety technology, those features. And EyeSight gives you a lot of safety technology and a lot of safety features, but I think that all of us found that it was at times more annoying than useful.
Oh my God, the safety feature. Subaru does give you the standard EyeSight system with pretty much all of their vehicles now, but it's always beeping at you.
I know, car.
When it loses detection of the lanes, it beeps at you. When you're using the automatic cruise control and it detects a car, it beeps at you. When the car leaves, it beeps at you. When you get too close to the site, it beeps at you, even though you're not really that close to the site. It's always beeping at you. And it's very difficult to actually shut some of these systems off, which you really don't want to do anyway, because you have this thing for those safety systems.
They're also the same beeps.
Yeah.
So you can't distinguish. And I think I found that when I was driving it on the highway, I knew it was beeping at me for a reason, I just didn't know what I had done wrong.
Yeah, many times I looked at it and said, what are you beeping at now?
And it doesn't give you like the benefit of extra technologies for that. Subaru's starting to get into some lane centering steering on some of its more recent redesigns, but this one was kind of the last one in before it got to that, and so this still doesn't have lane centering, which a lot of the other competitors do. But I want to get to the main thing. Let's talk about seating space, because it just doesn't have space. You get to the second row, you get to the third row. It bears mentioning the Explorer is kind of this way too, but I mean, in the Subaru, you can't really work out a great compromise for the second and the third row passengers to really have enough room for adults to sit in both rows, and no matter what, adults in the third row are just not going to have headroom.
The third row has a recline feature, but you just can't access it while you're sitting, so it might as well not have one. I would rather sit in pretty much anything else than that third row.
One of the big reasons for buying a three-row SUV is you want to be able to carry a lot of stuff. This one came at the bottom of the category.
Yeah, it was pretty bad in that regard. And it's not just cargo, but it's just kind of storage space in general. I mean, there's a tiny little slot there ahead of the cup holders. You could maybe throw a few CDs in, I guess, if you're still into that. But I mean, there's just not enough space under the armrest, you know, in the second row. There's just, these other SUVs are really made for families, and they have space for you to throw all your crap. And the Subaru, they tell you, well, we got 19 cup holders. Great, but you're going to have to cannibalize most of those cup holders to put other stuff because they didn't give you any space to put that other stuff.
Or they put a cup holder where useful space could have gone, and no one carries 19 cups around. So the question then is, how did the Ascent beat the other two contenders that ended up below it, even if it was by barely, I think we can point really to two things. Value, cheapest car in this test, and for that money, you do get a lot of features, annoying as they may be. Also, second highest car seat check score and tied for highest in safety feature score, objectively, even though we didn't necessarily like how they functioned.
Yeah, so it has a lot of equipment, objectively scoring, that really did quite well. A lot of equipment, not a lot of money for that equipment. It's just that, well, it drives you a little bit nuts.
The Ascent is good on paper, not so good to take home. And our fourth place finisher was the 2020 Ford Explorer, which was completely redesigned for this year. Also notable, the only vehicle to come on a rear-wheel drive platform. And I think that for better or worse, it added some things better and some things worse.
That rear-wheel drive platform really does create a vehicle that is actually fun to drive. I thought it was exceptional in terms of the body control, handling, steering feedback. I really like the powertrain as well. Now, this is the same powertrain that we've seen in the Mustang and the Ranger as well. You've got the turbocharged four-cylinder, 10-speed automatic, and I think it was dynamite. The thing always had power, always had torque. Acceleration was fantastic. I enjoyed driving this thing. I was telling people, I can't wait until they make a Mustang out of this platform because it's going to be a heck of a lot of fun to drive. But that rear-wheel drive platform, I think, also created some compromises in how you would use a mass-market SUV like this as well.
Yeah, I mean, it certainly changed the packaging. It's worth mentioning the prior generation Explorer, we didn't love, but it did have really nice high seats. The seats, especially in the third row, were nice and high off the floor. And with this redesign now, moving to this new platform, those seats are just jammed onto the floor, especially in the third row. Your knees are just way up in the air. They're kind of up in the air in the second row, too. I mean, it's just not a great packaged SUV in terms of family space.
Yeah, we measured each third row, the space between the seat cushion and the floor. The Explorer had the least, about 8 inches, and for perspective, that means that there's about a 3 or 4 inch gap between the bottom of my leg and the seat. And that's just fatiguing for passengers. It's just not comfortable. You don't put people back there that you like. You don't put people back there that you don't like because you don't wish that kind of evil on anyone. Second row seats, also, room was better, like you said, but yeah, not comfortable.
They're narrow. They're really narrow.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like if you're sitting in that seat and the car makes any kind of turn, because it is fun to drive, so you toss them to a corner. If anyone's sitting on that seat, they're going to end up either in the door or in the other seat.
And the front seats weren't really any better either because they're extremely short. So the seat bottom cushions, you always felt like you're sitting on the edge of the seat, which is, it's not an edge and it's Explorer.
Yeah, and also bears mentioning, the Explorer was the most expensive vehicle in our test. $54,000 and change. For me, it didn't feel like a $54,000 vehicle. I didn't find the materials to be that good. They weren't bad, but they weren't good. You also had kind of a smallish screen for a car that was redesigned this year, 8 inches. They offer a larger screen. Doesn't come in this trim level, which is kind of shocking that there are trim levels above this one, so you can punch an Explorer up to around $60,000 without much trouble.
And the fact that it cost this much and still didn't have all the equipment that you'd get on one of our top finishers that cost nearly $7,000 to $8,000 less, which I think is extraordinary.
That's a clear disparity. One area that the Explorer did do well was in-cabin storage. I mean, it didn't have a ton of cargo space, but when you got inside, I mean, there was a nice big center console between the captain's chairs and the second row, and so there was a lot of storage there. There were a bunch of pockets kind of up front, so there were a lot of areas to kind of throw your stuff, and that helped out kind of on the family friendliness quotient. Unfortunately, the seating space didn't.
One thing to watch out for with the Explorer, the wireless charging pad for your phone is not very big, so I have a phone that's a little bit on the larger side, not the largest phone, didn't actually fit there. So watch out for that. And it's also kind of nestled in that weird spot in front of the center console. I think that's indicative to me of an interior that's not particularly well thought out. I think that Ford did a lot of really good work on the powertrain and on the driving experience, but I think that more important in three-row SUVs is sort of how everything is configured. And I don't know if they necessarily paid enough attention to that.
Now, it did come in very strongly with certain safety features. It tied for first place with the Atlas and the Ascent for having the most standard safety features. Had a 360-degree camera, which really does help in any kind of navigation of a parking lot as well.
Especially since it had the tied for lowest visibility score.
Exactly. So that does help if you can't see out. You can at least see the screen and see what's around you. But in general, it had a lot of equipment, but it needed more to be a $54,000 vehicle.
Yeah, I want to get back to driving real quick, though. I mean, how did you guys think it rode? I thought none of these SUVs really were bad in terms of ride quality, but the Explorer seemed the closest to kind of overly firm for this group. I mean, if you're a family shopper, you might just want something that's sprung a little more softly. Now, it's worth saying, this isn't even the sportiest version of the Explorer. You can go all the way up to an Explorer ST, which has potentially even firmer underpinnings. And so this, for being kind of the family-friendly version, struck me as a little bit too firm in terms of ride quality.
I think they made a great platform to make a luxury SUV out of, which they did in the Lincoln Aviator. But I think the transition to rear-wheel drive and the focus on making it more sporty and entertaining, they lost some of the mass market appeal that Explorer really needs in order to compete with some of the other three-row competitors in this test.
Yeah, I think until the Explorer can become more competitive on price, it's going to kind of suffer for it. You end up paying more to get the same amount of equipment, and that's not a compromise that I think many families are willing to make.
And it's worth noting, I mean, this really stands in contrast to the criticisms we had at the beginning for the Pilot, which we thought, you know, these are kind of fixable things. These are kind of things that you could even tweak, you know, certainly with a redesign, but maybe even with kind of this mid-cycle freshening. And the Explorer seems like it's got a lot of inherent things that are just kind of making it the way it is. And so they're really going to have to rethink their whole idea of what a kind of mid-sized three-row SUV is supposed to be if they want to get away from this.
Our third place finisher is a familiar vehicle to us. So it's the Volkswagen Atlas, which actually won our test the last time we did this challenge 2 years ago. And then the Atlas went on to win our Best of 2018 award, which is our highest award that we can give to a vehicle. And then we bought one and owned one for a year. So the Atlas coming back and being in this challenge was like meeting an old friend again, and I'm happy to say that I thought it held up very well.
It really did, and the big reason that it does so well is because it's huge inside. The external footprint really isn't all that different from some of the other vehicles in this test, but Volkswagen has nailed the packaging of this thing. It has got a huge third row seat, a big second row seat, and it's easy to actually get into the third row because the second row folds and slides so far forward that it's really not that difficult at all. And once you're back there, there's tons of headroom, there's tons of width, there's plenty of legroom as well. It's something you can actually cart around seven people without a problem.
I would rather sit in the third row of the Atlas than in the second row of the Explorer or the Ascent. I mean, it was just really fantastic back there. And it's not just in that, it's in space as well. I mean, behind the third row, best in the group measured cargo space. You fold down the third row and close to the best for room behind the second row. Just a really, really nicely packaged vehicle. But let's get over to some of the misses here, specifically interior quality.
Yeah, not great. And the thing is, it's very plasticky. It does have some nice trim. It's got some fancier leather in it, but even the fanciest leather out of a Volkswagen doesn't hold a candle to some of the best vinyl I've seen in some of the other manufacturers. I could hear panels creaking as you were accelerating and decelerating, and just from the fact that it was getting warm and cool. You shouldn't be hearing that on a brand new vehicle. It still needs an upgrade to its interior appointments before I think it's going to reclaim any kind of top spots.
And some upgrades to its interior styling, honestly. I mean, those climate controls have been in Volkswagen products for like 15 years now, or close to it, and I mean, they still kind of have this rickety, insubstantial feel to them. The multimedia system has more capacitive touch buttons, and I mean, I just found it difficult to use. When I had my phone plugged into Apple CarPlay to go and change the radio station, I had to completely exit out of the whole interface and go to another radio interface. I mean, you compare that to, for example, in the Hyundai or the Kia, you just use the tuning knob and you're able to surf your stations while you're still on Apple CarPlay. So some big differences there in terms of user interface.
I think there's something to be said for Volkswagen's kind of aesthetic that they have in their vehicles. Because I agree with you that the interior quality is not quite there, but for example, in the Pilot, it's all black. It doesn't really look good. But I think that the Atlas still looks good. So objectively, I can kind of get by the interior not being quite as high quality because I think it's stylish. And I think if you like that kind of minimalist Volkswagen look, then it will still appeal to you. And if you also like bright seats, then it will appeal to you, and I like those.
It looks good, but you know, it's an interior, you gotta touch it. And when you touch it, it really doesn't feel good.
Yeah, I did think Volkswagen really nailed drivability. It's got a big V6 engine, a little bit tall gearing, presumably for fuel economy, and so you're kind of winding out, you know, second, third gear and waiting a long time while it gets up to speed. But overall, nails ride and handling. I mean, just a fun to drive vehicle in terms of its steering. It's light yet direct. I mean, it really, really does a nice job there. And ride quality, fairly composed, just a nice riding vehicle, very comfortable without losing much control.
Yeah, getting back into the Atlas and driving it again, transmission's a little wonky for me, but everything else is buttoned down very nicely. I had forgotten actually how nice this vehicle was to just kind of drive around town. So good to get a reminder of that. I do want to circle back to one of the big, big strengths of the Atlas for those who have families: highest car seat check score out of the field. So All that room in the second and third rows, all that travel in the second row, really makes it easy to install and take out car seats. One final thing to note on the Atlas for value. So it was mid-pack in price, but it was also the only 2019 model in our test. And for Volkswagen, that's significant because in 2020, Volkswagen is no longer going to offer its best in the business 6-year, 72,000-mile bumper-to-bumper warranty. So if you're gonna pick up an Atlas, I would personally go look for a 2019 because you get a more robust warranty, and in 2020, that will shrink. Much like we had a very tight finish at the bottom of this test, we also had a very, very tight finish at the top. And that makes sense when you consider our top two finishers, the second place Kia Telluride and the first place Hyundai Palisade. Both brand new for 2020, both from Korean automakers, and I think as some car buyers might not know, very, very similar vehicles on the same platform with the same powertrains, and really just differences to the bodies and the interiors in terms of materials and kind of what you touch. So Hyundai and Kia would say, everything that you see and touch on the vehicle is different, but the bones of it structurally, it's pretty much the same, and that's reflected in the results that we had.
Yeah, and they kind of drove like that. I mean, just really, really refined vehicles in both the Hyundai and the Kia. Nice powertrain, a big 3.8 liter V6, gave you lots of power immediately when you needed it. No real problems with the transmission. Ride quality was kind of a cut above a lot of these other cars, I thought. I mean, there are different shock absorbers between the Kia and the Hyundai. The Kia supposedly rides a little bit softer, according to officials, and it does a little bit, but the Hyundai also kind of has a little bit more control. But when you drive these two compared to the rest of the field, they're kind of on their own island, wouldn't you say?
I would. I think they drive really quite well for what they are. But what really strikes you about it is that these are also on the larger end of the spectrum for these vehicles. They are almost as big as the Atlas and the Traverse. There's tons of space in the first and second row. And the third row, not the biggest, but still comfortable enough for full-sized adults without a problem to get, and it's easy to get back there. Tons of cargo room as well. But what really kind of strikes me about this is that you get all these features. You get all the nice interior. You get on the Hyundai the digital dash. You get the side view cameras, displays that pop up in the central cluster as well, and you get this for $46,000-$47,000, which is several thousand dollars less than the Americans, where you don't get all that equipment.
Yeah, it's about an $8,000 gap between the Telluride, which was the second cheapest vehicle in our test, and the Explorer. And I think that the Telluride, even though it had the second lowest price, had the second nicest interior, and the Palisade had the third lowest price and the nicest interior. So we're talking about these vehicles together because lots of similarities, and that's true, but there are also a few differences I think that we want to highlight between the Kia and the Hyundai that give them a little bit of daylight, and we also had a bit of controversy in our judging results that we'll get into in a minute as well. But it starts, I think, with the Palisade's features. So Palisade does offer a few things that you don't get on the Telluride, starting with a power folding third row, which is a very convenient feature, and also that all digital gauge cluster, which it uses to great effect with the blind spot camera system. So two big differences there. And also in the center console, you're looking at a button shifter versus a traditional shift knob, which I know that we have some different opinions on.
Yeah, see, that's for me, when we did all of our scoring, we all scored them very differently. I think, Kelsey, you had the Kia as your top rated.
Just a tad, yeah.
Bike. Just very similar, but still you rate that as tops. You ranked the Hyundai as tops, and I had them tied. So that kind of interesting to see how that all plays out, but that just shows how very similar they both are. And it came down to the little bitty details like that, like the push button transmission. I'm not a huge fan of push button transmissions. I think they're kind of difficult to use when you need to use them quickly. But then the Kia, which had a regular shifter, also had a lot of the controls located a little bit too far aft towards your elbow, whereas the Hyundai's push button shifter and that design of the console enabled them to put a lot of stuff a lot further forward. You didn't have to reach or look down to find anything. But then the Kia didn't have the power folding third row seats. So I mean, a lot of it came down to just what could you get on one model versus the other, and which did you really prefer?
Yeah, I mean, it was just a kind of collection of differences in some of the equipment. I think that's what put Kia just over the top for me, some of the features it had that the Palisade didn't. I know the Palisade did have the fancy gauges. It also had the power folding third row, but it didn't have, you know, one-touch rear windows. It didn't have power folding mirrors. And so just a few features here and there that kind of reflect the packaging differences between the two. But really overall, I mean, both of them clearly winners.
I would agree with you that a push button gear selector is not as easy or intuitive to use as a traditional shift lever. However, in the Palisade, it uses it to what I would say is great effect because it opens up another very large storage space underneath where the gear shifter would go. So actually three large storage spaces in the front of the Palisade, one underneath the console, one in the front where the cup holders are, and the cup holders will actually spin out when you don't need them anymore and open up another bin for you, and then a fairly large center storage bin. And I think for families, especially where you have things like purses or diaper bags, you can actually fit a fairly large bag underneath that front storage space. So that's something that none of the other vehicles in the test really had, and that gave the Palisade a leg up for me. I just think it's more usable overall and a touch nicer on the inside. That diamond cut stitching really looks luxury.
Yeah, and the Palisade does have some kind of nicer touch points, areas where your kind of knees go up against the doors or the center console. Those are padded in the Kia, they're kind of harder plastics. But I mean, this really gets back to kind of some of the enduring qualities of these two SUVs. A lot of times, you know, the top place finisher, for a lot of aesthetic reasons, gets it. It's kind of, it has the most new technology, it's got the nicest styling it's got. I mean, it and in these cases, both of these SUVs really have a lot of family-friendly qualities that probably will stand the test of time. Things like lots of seating space, lots of storage space. They both drive pretty well, onward and onward. We see how well the Volkswagen Atlas aged from being one of our favorite vehicles a few years ago. I think it's safe to say these two seem like they're going to age pretty well.
I would also say that these two vehicles to me seem like Atlas enhanced. So a lot of the weaknesses that we cited in the Atlas are fixed on these two. Better transmission, better interior quality, better materials, things don't really move around, feels well built, feels luxurious. The quietest vehicles in the test for me were the Hyundai and the Kia, and 5 years ago, if you had told me I'd be saying that, I would have been like, you are lying.
And best fuel economy as well, which is kind of extraordinary given that they both have big V6s, Atkinson cycle V6 as well, which is meant to improve their fuel economy somewhat. But to have such a large vehicle, I mean, the Kia won our fuel economy challenge with 24.5 miles per gallon on average, which is an extraordinary number for a vehicle this large and a vehicle and an engine that big.
Was there anything they didn't nail? For me, one thing that I wish they had done a little bit better job of was just widening some of that seating space up front. It did seem a little bit narrow, especially compared to some of our cars that finished considerably worse, like the Traverse had a lot more space. The Hyundai and the Kia both seemed just a little bit pinned in, but I mean, we're really splitting hairs here to try to find things we didn't like about these vehicles.
Not great car seat check scores, but I went over my notes before we started talking about these, and really the negatives that I had were me reaching or me nitpicking. And I think that there were two clear vehicles that really stood out in this test, and they proved it with their finish in both the objective and subjective categories.
They nailed them. They really did nail it.
Just to circle back to value on both of these vehicles, I think that if we had flipped the prices, so let's say that the Ford and the Chevy had been the $46,000, $47,000 vehicles, and these two had cost $54,000, no one would have been surprised given the quality that they have on the interior and how refined they feel when you drive them. And then the fact that you get them for a lower price and you also get a very robust warranty that won't be going away for 2020. So a 5-year, 60,000 mile bumper to bumper warranty on both of the Koreans just speaks to their value even more.
This really does demonstrate how this test came into three different groupings. We had the lower three, so when we say about last place, there wasn't really a last place. There was a grouping of them that were all very similar. Then we had the Ford and the Volkswagen together, which they had their strengths and they had their weaknesses. There was a 60-point difference between the lower tier and the top tier in this test of the Hyundai and the Kia, and that really just shows us just how good they were compared to, you know, the older entrants into this in this category. I think it was definitely a deserved win.
For the full results, scoring, and how we tested for this challenge, head over to Cars.com.